groggy. We're gonna see if we can get through this without barking at you today. What I want to do is I want to do something kind of new, kind of not new. I want to have some fun, so that's kind of not new because I always want to kind of have some fun. And remember the secret that it's okay to have fun in church. Remember, it really is. So what I want to do today is, and this is scary because this is something I had to practice with audience participation, which I couldn't do. So we're gonna see how this works. Okay? Simply put, I want you guys to think of a person that you know who exemplifies humility. All right, they're not perfect, but when you think of a humble person, yeah, it's that guy. Right, if you could open up a dictionary and look up humility or humbleness, you would see a picture of that person. Okay, that's the person I want you to think of. You got that person in mind? Everybody, most everybody? Again, I tried to practice this without audience participation. It's really tough. Never know what you're gonna get for this first 2 minutes opening here, okay? You got the name? You got your coffee? You guys good? Ready? Okay, on the count of three, I want you to shout out that person's name. Really simple, right? Okay, let's try this. 1, 2, 3, go. Yes, I was hoping it would sound like that. Okay, now what I want you to do is very similar, but just a little bit different. Now I want you to think of someone who's not humble. Think of someone who's maybe arrogant, maybe prideful. But here's the deal, okay? Here's one rule. If they're sitting next to you, you can't say their name. And I don't want elbows flying. I'm not trying to open up a brawl. If they're sitting next to you, just say some other name, okay? You know, my name, my go-to is Bob. If I hear a bunch of Bobs, I'll be like, But if somebody else hears Bob, they'll be like, So, again, think of that name, but if they're next to you, don't say the same, some other name, okay? All right, on the count of three, same thing. 1, 2, 3, go. Wow. I heard Bob. Oh, my. I heard a Bob. I'm so sorry for whoever you're sitting by. Guys, the point to this is pretty simple. I think humility is something that's difficult for us to define. It's something that I think we struggle with as well. I mean, I don't think there's anybody sitting here today who says, oh, I got it all figured out. If you are, then this message is especially for you because we're talking about humility today. But guys, in a sense, I think it's something that we struggle with. Humility is it's something that requires us to remove our mask. And I don't mean that we're phony or fake. What I mean, though, to be humble, we really have to be open. We really need to be honest. We need to be transparent. We need to be almost uncomfortable sometimes as well. And I think those are difficult things for us to show those kinds of things, to show our brokenness. Because that's really what it comes down to. And it's tough for us to do that. It's sometimes good, though. Trust me, it's sometimes good when people can look at you and they can say, man, you're a mess, but so am I. What's your secret? Or you're broken and so am I. What's your secret? How do you get through it? So there's some good to that. There's a lot of good to being humble. But Jesus tells us today specifically that it's lacking in our world. Actually, if you guys want to go ahead and turn there, go ahead and turn there now and get that out of the way. The text is, let me make sure. There we go, 14. I was going to share Luke 14 because I was like, where are we today? So Luke 14 today. So if you have your Bible, like me, just go New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke. If you have your smartphones, open up your Bible apps, Luke chapter 14. Again, this concept of humility. And guys, let me share something with you. We'll see how well you can multitask if you can find the text and listen at the same time. This is true story. I read that a couple years ago, the number one shoplifted item in the United States was Preparation H. It's totally true. Number one shoplifted item in the U.S. a couple of years back was Preparation H, which is kind of funny because that tells me that we would rather steal and risk getting caught, or risk, you know, some jail time. We would rather do that than to be honest, to be transparent, and allow people to not see but to know that we have hemorrhoids. Kind of funny. But guys, that's part of our brokenness. That's part of removing that mask that I'm talking about. We don't want people to see the broken. We don't want them to see the hurt and the scars and the wounds that we carry. But guys, that's part of being humble. It's showing that that we're human. That we're real people. That we're not phonies. We're not plastic. We're not make-believe, okay? So guys, this concept of humility, it's nothing new. I'm sure you guys have heard this type of message probably a million times, maybe not quite a million, but a lot of times. And Jesus tells us today that it's lacking, not just in his world, which we're going to see, but in our world today. So if you guys are ready, let's go ahead and start getting in the text. It's already on the screen, so it keeps this easy for us. It's Luke 14. We're going to start reading in verse 7. And let's try not to bark at me too much when we get my throat clear. So starting in verse 7, this is talking about Jesus. It says, when he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. So pretty simple. Jesus is at, this is the last of the third time that Jesus will be at a Pharisee's house. He's over at this guy's house. There's some sort of feast and celebration that's going to take place. I don't know if he's standing or sitting because the text isn't really clear. It doesn't really matter, but Jesus is watching as people are coming in. And they're coming in and they're starting to fight over who gets the best seat in the house. Again, remembering, going back to what we've discussed in previous sermons, wealth was kind of important, yes, but honor. That's what this society thrived on. So it was all about honor. So when you walked in, you kind of knew. I mean, you could walk into the room and you could look around. You kind of knew where you fit on the social ladder. But you would still try to get a better seat. If you knew you were here, you could still try to get a little further. And it was kind of okay. You could bump up a seat or two. But if you got too audacious, I mean, man, the host is going to come over and grab you and move you. And that's a bad thing. And so you didn't want that to happen. So Jesus is watching these guys come in, and they're kicking and clawing and fighting. There's elbows thrown and driving knees, and maybe not that bad, but they're being real childish in what they're doing, fighting for that choice place. Now the table, just keep in mind as well, would be a horseshoe. So like this big U-shaped table, be about 6 inches off the ground with some pillows. So when you hear about Jesus reclining at the table with the disciples, they weren't kicking back in lazy boys. They were really reclining. They were really reclining at the table. And the place of honor was right here at the very top of the horseshoe. This is where the honored guest would sit right here. And then the next honored would sit to the right. And then the next honored to the left. And the next to the right and left. And so on and so forth. All the way down the table. So you could kind of squeeze up a space. Maybe two seats if you were really, really good. Depending on who was there. You could kind of squeeze up a little bit. But Jesus is watching this, he sees what's going on, and he sees the childishness, and then because of this, he launches into the parable for today, which starts in verse 8. And Jesus says this, when someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. So he's watching these guys fight and kick and scream and claw, right? And try to get the best seats that they possibly can. And he's saying, guys, don't do that. Just knock it off. It's just really being stupid. It's being childish. It's being immature. I kind of wonder if he's looking at certain someones, though. Right? I kind of think back as a parent. You know, when your little kids are out there and they're playing with a bunch of other kids and you got like this mess of kids, right? Like 10 kids maybe. And if somebody gets hurt, guys, you got to know how that goes. Someone's crying, and then you come out there, and you know, it's either mom or dad, whatever, you're kind of like wrangle the kids together, and you're like, okay, what's going on, what happened? You know it's the 7-year-old with the tattoo and the sick pack of cigarettes, right? You know, okay, maybe not that, but you know, you kind of have an idea which ones are the troublemakers, right? They're the ones standing there with a lead pipe. What's up? Okay. Anyways, you know, it's some of those. And you're trying to talk to the group, you don't want to single anybody out, you know, but you kind of like, and we don't do that kind of behavior, do we, right? You kind of eyeball somebody. I wonder if Jesus is doing that. You know, not calling him out like, Bob, I want you to know, but really kind of, you know, he's watching the guys walk in and he's saying, look, don't do that. Don't be a bonehead, okay? Kind of think about today, like 2019, going to a wedding and a wedding rehearsal? What are they called?
Reception.
Reception! Thank you! See, I don't even know these things. Okay, let's just pray and close for the day. Okay, so wedding reception. Okay, so if you're got a wedding, invite me so I can get hip on these things again, okay? Wedding reception. All right, so you got this table up front. Not the communion table, but you have this table up front here. This is for the bride and the groom and a couple others, you know, maid of honor, best man, you know, a couple individuals that could be here. All the rest of the tables are kind of like where you guys are. facing the bridegroom. Bridegroom, we're facing that way. Table of honor. This is where the honored guests sit. Can you imagine going to a wedding? And I don't care, guys, if you know these people, if you know who's getting married, if you're just a friend of a friend of somebody's former roommate, you know, whatever. It doesn't matter. But imagine going to the wedding reception and seeing somebody walk up and sit down. And you know that guy shouldn't be there. And you're thinking, oh, Bozo, what are you doing? Right? You know the guy doesn't belong at that table. He just walks up and takes a seat. You'd be thinking, what? What's up with that? It's kind of the same thing that's happening with Jesus right here. And he's watching these guys come in and fight over the choice seats. And these guys, he says, guys, look, don't do that kind of stuff. Because like, you're important. Let me just say, you are, okay? But someone more important than you may have been invited here as well. You don't know that. And if so, actually, verse 9, if so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this person your seat. And then, humiliated, you have to take the least important place. Ah, you have to do the walk of shame. And that's what we called it back in high school. And I am old, I know. That was 30 years ago, but it was still fun. You see dogs and cats with the cone of shame, right? Put the cone around. It's like kind of the same thing. The walk of shame is just as embarrassing. I think that's the animal version, actually, really, the cone of shame. But you got to do that walk of shame. The guy comes over and he's going to have to tell you. Now remember, it's not just like he could come over, you know, you're sitting down and you'd be like, hey, Bob, yeah, I need you to move. Come with me. Right? He can't just do that. You're on the floor. You know, it's kind of like, hey, Bozo, moron, look this way. You're over here. You kind of got it. He's really got to wrestle to get your attention. Plus, even if he was super discreet by saying, hey, Bob, yeah, you, yeah, over here. Everybody would still notice he gets up and walks with you, okay? They would see it. It's just, that's humility. That's the walk of shame. In fact, Wikipedia defines the walk of shame as this. It's a situation in which a person must walk past strangers or peers alone for an embarrassing reason before reaching a place of safety and privacy. You know me, I'm goofy. You think of me, I just think of like, right, they get up and they have to walk, and then everybody else just like forms this line, right? This like form this tunnel, and you gotta walk through the center of it, and they're standing on either side of it, and they're shooting spit wads at you, right? And they're just throwing food at you, and they're laughing and joking, and of course it's all like muted. I probably saw this in a movie somewhere, I don't know, knowing my brain. But right, this is the walk of shame, and you're like super slow. It's only like 15 feet, but it feels like 100, right? By the time you get to the end of it, it's rough, it's embarrassing. Now, for us, though, guys, think about it. Western culture, Western mindset, yeah, that's not cool. We don't want to do that. It's embarrassing. Yeah, but like 10 minutes later, we're fine. Maybe not all of us, but for most of us, we're like, yeah, that was good. I did something that was stupid. Whatever. We move on. We kind of go on with that. But in their culture, you've got to put yourself in their sandals. Remember, it's all about honor. It's all about your place in society. So this was a big deal back then. It still is today. Even today, over in the Middle East, if you go there and you invite someone over to your house for dinner, and there's a crowd of people that hear them, they will say yes. Even if they're not going to show up. Even if they're like, nope, I'm getting in my car and we're going south. I mean, they will not plan on it, but they will say it because it's shameful. In their culture, it's shameful in a crowd to turn you down. I know for us that sounds weird, but for them that's shameful. So try to take, again, the mindset of that, multiply it by 100, and that's almost where we're at in the text today. It's all about honor. Jesus says, don't be boneheaded about this. If you show up, it's possible there's someone else that is more important, more distinguished than you, and if they sit down, or you sit down in their spot, the host is going to move you, and then you've got to do the walk of shame, so it's not a good idea. And then he gives this advice in verse 10. He says, so he's saying, hey, don't do that, but rather do this. But when you're invited, take the lowest place. So when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all the other guests. This isn't news to us, is it? A couple weeks from now, we're gonna talk about the wise and the foolish builder. We're gonna see that probably 2 weeks from now. And there's only one thing that's, man, I just let the cat out of the bag, aren't I? because I'm going to ask the question then. You guys don't know the answer. How about that? I'm giving you the answer to a question that I'm going to ask in a couple weeks. All right, there's one difference between the two guys. One, the major difference is one person took Jesus' words and he put them into practice. That was really the only difference. They both heard the same exact words. They both had the same exact building materials. They both had exactly the same everything. Just one took Jesus' words and put them into practice. That's it. Kind of the same thing that's going on for us in the text. I mean, Jesus is at the house of a Pharisee. These guys were steeped. I think of old brother Arthur, steeped in old timey goodness. Yeah, they were steeped in the Old Testament. I mean, really, these guys knew the laws and the commandments upside down, forwards, backwards, inside out. They didn't do very well, living them out. But they knew them. They really did. And one of their heroes, one of their favorite guys in all the world, King Solomon, wrote some words that were very similar to what Jesus is saying. In fact, he wrote them 900 years before the text that we're looking at today. And this is what Solomon says in Proverbs 25, verses 6 and 7. It says, "Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence. Do not claim a place among his great men. It is better for him to say to you, 'Come up here,' than for him to humiliate you before his choice nobles." Yeah, again, walk of shame. Solomon wrote about it 3,000 years ago. Jesus is talking about it 2,000 years ago, and we still have it today, guys. It still happens to us today because it's that mask that we have to take off with humility. We don't want to do that. We don't want to show our brokenness. We struggle with that. And then Jesus finishes the parable by saying these words in verse 11. "For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." That's the point that he's trying to make. All these guys, kicking and clawing and fighting and fussing, trying to get the best seat in the entire house, and Jesus says, no. If you exalt yourself, you'll be humbled. But if you humble yourself, you'll be exalted. Actually, I want to read those words again, but what I'd like you to do is just close your eyes. Just listen to the words that Jesus says. I mean, we can read them on the screen and everything, but I think there's a little more depth when we close our eyes, just get in the moment, and just listen to what Jesus says, right? This is what he says. He says, "For all who exalt themselves will be humbled. And for those who humble themselves will be exalted." Okay, the point is simple. And the point is really simple. And this is really good. If you want to write this down, this is perfect. Jesus is saying, be humble or be humbled. And that's really, those are the only choices we get. Be humble or be humbled. And so if it's something you want to write down, I would encourage you to do so. If this is something that you need, we know there's a Bob already in the room. So but seriously, this is something, you can put this on your fridge, you can put this on a mirror in your bathroom, you can put this on your dashboard in your car, this can go on your desk or your workspace. This can be with you at all times, so you constantly reflect and honestly ask yourself, which one are you, humble or humbled? Because you're going to be one of the two. And look, here's the deal with all of this. Guys, Jesus just says, start humbling. He's not saying, don't have any ambition, just be lazy, aim as low as you possibly can. He's not saying that. He's just saying when you walk into a situation, you might be the most important one in the room, but don't act as if you are. Humble yourself. Allow others to exalt you in the process. Paul basically says the same words in Philippians 2, verse 3, but this is a paraphrase. This is the Message Bible, one of my favorites as far as paraphrasing. This is what he says. "Don't push your way to the front. Don't sweet talk your way to the top. Put yourself aside and help others get ahead. Don't be obsessed with getting your own advantage. Forget yourselves long enough to lend a helping hand." Here's the deal with that. We know this, right? I mean, we know these things, don't we? I mean, just be honest. Just go ahead and answer. We know these things? Yes, yeah. I don't think there's anybody here sitting here today who's saying, I never realized it was bad to be a pompous, arrogant jerk. I never thought it wasn't cool to be rude. I never thought it was a bad thing to just look out for myself yourself and not care about anybody else in the world. You guys, you know these things. You know these things, right? I mean, this is something we don't really even have to discuss, but yet we're discussing it because there's a reason. There has to be a reason, guys, why we struggle with this so much. We know it. We know it 100%, but yet we still struggle. Why? Why do we struggle with it? Why do we struggle with humility? With, again, removing that mask, allowing authenticity just to show brokenness. Letting people know we don't have it all figured out. We still have hurts. We have scars. We have wounds. That's part of being humble, just showing that. Being real people. There are people in this world who want to see us. They don't want to see plastic fruit. You know, the fruit of the Spirit, I think sometimes Christians walk around and we're plastic fruit. We're afraid to remove that mask. We're afraid to let them see that we're real people, that we have hurts and we have brokenness. Guys, I think we struggle with humility for I can give you many reasons, but I want to share two with you today. And I'm hoping, like always, that these two will encompass basically everything, okay? The first reason I believe we struggle with humility, we value what the world values. I think of James and John. And they're standing here and they're having this discussion with Jesus. And they're talking with him, and the discussion is starting to get a little bit heated. Starting to steam up a little bit because you've got all the disciples here too. Now they're all getting frustrated as well. They're all getting frustrated because somebody who said, "Hey bro, I got your back," now is suddenly stabbing them in the back. Somebody who said, "No, I'm a team player," now is suddenly not a team player. And they're back with this group who is stabbing them in the back. And you've got, again, James and John standing here speaking with Jesus, and the whole entire crew, all these guys are getting frustrated. I mean, you can just sense the tension in the air because they're having this talk with Jesus. It's almost coming to a fight. I mean, you can almost sense that would be the next step if this progresses the way it is. And then worse than what you've got here is you've got someone bringing their mom to the fight. When you're a little kid, you kind of just expect it. Sometimes you're like, "Yeah, I need Mama Bear." Because the kid with the tattoos and the cigarettes is about to beat me with a lead pipe again, you know? It's like, well, you want mom in there. That's not a bad thing. But when you're a grown man and mom comes to the fight, guys, it's just not cool on any level. It's just not. We know this, right? We don't want mom to come to our rescue at that point. But that's exactly what happens. This discussion is taking place and mom walks up and says, hey, Jesus. I want my boys to sit right in the left of your throne. That would be really awesome. That would be really super great. One on the right, one on the left. Yeah, if you could just do that, then we'd be good to go. And you know, the disciples are over here thinking, what? Because that's what they want. They all want the same thing. They want to sit in that place of honor. They want to sit to the right or to the left. And so it's like, it's on, right? Like Donkey Kong, maybe you got to get ready to throw down. Even James and John got to be standing there going, wait a minute. One on the right, one on the left. Which one's on the right? Who's on the left? Right? And I mean, even they could start to throw down over this. And in the midst of this, you can kind of feel the tension building, and then Jesus just says, stop. Just stop. Time out. Pause, as Steve would say. Just stop. Knock it off. Because the deal is they're looking at the values of the world. Jesus says, here's the deal. I don't run my kingdom by those values. I use a different scorecard. I have different standards. You're in the world, but you're not of it. Read the name tag. You're in my world now. And in my world, as a citizen, in my kingdom, we don't do those things. Remember, it's that upside down, inside out, backwards gospel that we talk about? And I say that because that's how it seems, right? If you want to live, you have to die. If you want to be first, you have to be last, yeah. And if you want to be the greatest, you have to be a servant to all. It's just backwards, upside down compared to what the world says. And in the midst of that, Jesus is standing here saying, guys, let me tell you what this is all about in humility and in equal or easy terms. Easy, that is, if you exalt yourself, you will be humbled. And if you humble yourself, you will be exalted. But I think we gravitate toward the values of the world. I think they just pull us in sometimes. If you look around you, 1 John 2:15 and 16 says that the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, they're not from the Father. Those are things of the world. And God says, all around us. You can't drive down the road without seeing billboards everywhere bombarding us. It's anything and everything for sale. You go to a checkout line, and as you walk into the checkout, you're bombarded. There's all kinds of stuff. Chocolate. I know certainly someone in here doesn't want to see the chocolate there because it's a temptation. It's everywhere. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life. You watch a TV commercials. Man, they're loaded. Yeah, why buy a car? You can buy a Cadillac. You know, you deserve that. It's like we kind of buy into the world's values because they're everywhere. They're kind of saturated throughout our entire environment. I think we're drawn into that. And so I think that's one reason why we really struggle with humility. We tend to value the things of this world, or what the world values. But the second reason, I think, is we compare ourselves with others rather than with Jesus. I know most of you are going to go to work tomorrow at a company that probably has a kiss-up and kick-down culture. What I mean is, you basically do whatever you have to do to climb up that ladder to get the person above you down and get above them. I don't mean you specifically, seriously, I don't, but I just mean culture-wise, there are companies that have that kind of a mindset. You come in and you do whatever it is. And I know, like, you bust your butt, you do your job, you work super hard, you know that there's a promotion coming up, you know that you're the perfect fit for that. You talk to whomever that is above you, supervisors, managers, whatever, they're all on the same page with you. They're saying, it's in the bag, you just gotta keep doing what you're doing, you got this, no sweat, easy peasy. You keep doing what you're doing, and then when it comes to that time, what happens? Somebody else gets a promotion. And you get blindsided. You deserved it. Been there, done that. It's not so fun. And it's really easy at that moment to start comparing yourself with others around you. Start comparing yourself with the other employees, the other workers, your friends, your classmates, your neighbors. Start starting to compare yourself with every single person in this world. But guys, we don't do that with Jesus. And I think that's what we need to do. I think that's the solution, is comparing ourselves with Jesus. Guys, how many of you have seen the movie The Passion of the Christ? Just by show of hands, Mel Gibson. Most of you. If you haven't, I would highly recommend seeing it. It is brutal. I will tell you that right now. It's tough to watch. It really is. Because that is just really taking the light, fluffy story that we see of the Jesus with the blue eyes and blonde hair, that's taking that out of the picture and going just about as real as we could get. And honestly, for once, Hollywood did a pretty good job. Pretty good job. It really takes the last 12 hours of Jesus' life and puts it into perspective. And there's one scene in the movie that is really difficult to get through. This is where Jesus is being beaten and scourged. Remember we talked about the scourging before? The Romans, man, they had this mask. They didn't just use the whips, which, you know, had the leather straps. They would tie bone and rocks and glass. And, I mean, they would tie things into it. So when they would whip you, it wouldn't just leave marks. It would dig into the flesh. And then when they pull back, it tears. Okay? And I know that sounds horrible and graphic, but guys, this is real life, so this is what really happened. And in the scene, in the movie, there's a scene where Jesus has his hands, you can see it on the screen, his hands are shackled together, and he's chained to a post, and he's just getting whipped with this cat of nine tails, and there's blood everywhere, and it's a horrible mess. And while I think of that, I try to come back to this image instead. That one's actually easier for me to look at. But the thought is still the same. This is what we should be comparing ourselves to. Not others around us. Guys, let me close with this. You know, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, and he's in the upper room, they're going to have their Last Supper. Are they going to do communion there? All right, you know all these things. All the disciples are coming in. They're all showing up one by one, and they walk in the door, and everybody's there, but there's one person that's missing. One person who's very important, but that person isn't there. And it's the servant over here. It's the foot washer. You didn't want to be that guy. I'm just saying. In that culture, that society, you didn't want to be the foot washer. That was the lowest of all the servants. If that was your job and somebody got hired, you were happy. because that was a promotion day, because somebody else gets to do that job. And it was miserable because, look, they lived in a culture where they wore sandals, it was dusty, it was dirty, sweaty, icky, muddy, sticky. I mean, this would just be just bad, okay? Just, you know, they're dirty when they walk in. They see that there's no one there. There's no servant there to come over to wash their feet. They notice that they don't even wash their own feet, and Jesus sees it. And when he sees it, remember what he does? He takes off the outer garment, right? The heavier robe, and he puts on that apron. And we talked about this before, too. In the church, we either wear aprons or we wear bibs. Apron is a servant. Jesus put on that apron as a servant. All the disciples walking in, they got their bibs nice and snug and ready to go. They just want to be spoon-fed. And Jesus goes and he takes each and every single one of these guys and he kneels down, he gets down on his knees and he washes their feet. Every single one of those stinky, sweaty, icky, nasty feet does that for all of, including Judas, the guy who betrayed him. And Jesus knows it. He knows that he's just sold him for a handful of silver. And yet what does he do? He gets that water. And he gets down on his knee, and he grabs those feet, those stinky, nasty feet, and he washes them. Guys, that's humility. That's our scorecard. That's our standard. We've got to stop comparing ourselves to others and compare ourselves to Jesus. And so if you're here this morning, and this is the biggest thing, if you're here and you don't know Jesus in the way we're talking, you don't have that kind of relationship with him when you know him as Savior, you know him as Lord, then we want to make that right. And so what we're going to do is we're going to stand in a few moments and sing a song together. We're